This week on The Gadget Show.
In our latest Tested to Destruction, we take rugged digital cameras to hell and back in Iceland. Are they tough enough to survive? Volcanoes, bubbling mud pits, and Jason in swimming trunks. How much punishment can they bear?
Jon enlists the help of 400-metre champion Iwan Thomas and an electric bike to test gadget trainers.
And finally, I get to test drive a new personal transport gadget that's actually rather good.
Hello and welcome to The Gadget Show.
Right, let's get straight to it, because we've been testing gadgets to destruction again, getting all mean and nasty. And this week we want to find out what is the best ruggedised digital camera you can buy.
So whether you get your kicks jumping out of aeroplanes or going on your skateboard down very steep hills, or maybe just putting them under a very hot jacuzzi and taking sly shots, you want to make sure that your camera is rugged enough to stand the elements and a bit of rough and tumble.
Yeah, more and more ruggedised cameras are hitting the market now, but which type should you go for?
One of these uber-tough, macho-looking, purpose-built units designed specifically to be chucked around and abused.
Or should you go for something like these, sort of undercover rugged cameras? They look like any other sleek little silver boxes and won't look out of place on a girl's night out, while in fact, they're as tough as nails.
Now, here on The Gadget Show, whenever we find a gadget that calls itself tough, we like to get violent with it and test it to destruction.
And traditionally, we've done all the work. We've cooked stuff, beaten stuff up, hosed stuff down, and blown stuff up. But this time, we decided to let Mother Nature do the work. So we took these four rugged cameras to a place where we could expose them to the nastiest and most extreme punishment that our planet has to offer.
Slap bang in the middle of the North Atlantic, Iceland is one of the most volcanic regions in the world. Over half the island is barren wasteland, littered with hot springs, thermal mud pools, and smoking volcanoes.
In this thoroughly appropriate environment, we're testing some of the most rugged and extreme digital cameras on Earth. What better place could there be to let nature do its worst? And what better place to start than in a helicopter?
Rugged cameras get used in all sorts of extreme situations, so they need to be easy to operate.
This was no ordinary helicopter ride. We'd be hanging out the door with the wind rushing past at 100 miles an hour and the massive vibrations from the blades shaking us to the bone.
This was a real challenge. Our cameras needed to do the amazing Icelandic scenery justice, otherwise they'd be next to useless.
I was first in the doorway. This 7.1 megapixel camera only claims to be waterproof, but its sturdy metal construction makes it a pretty tough customer.
You know, even though we're really moving a lot in the helicopter, this has got a digital shake reduction. Takes a really clear picture, watch.
My other rugged little silver box is the new 7.1 megapixel Olympus Mu. This pretty little thing hides a kick-ass attitude. It's shockproof, waterproof, crushproof, and freeze-proof, which could be useful up here. The wind rushing past and the vibration of the blades made for a bumpy, chilly ride, and my frozen fingers found the menu a bit fiddly, but overall, it was a pretty simple camera to use. Both the cameras have a 2.5-inch LCD screen with a kind of bright mode to make them visible in any conditions, and both have high ISO settings that allow more light onto the chip, making for better pictures. About halfway through the flight, we found a steaming volcanic crater.
Look at that steam! I don't know if it's coming across on camera, but this is amazing!
And with Jason now in the doorway, we headed off to continue our bone-shaking mission.
I've opted for more targeted cameras, ones built specifically for extreme sports or rugged environments. My first foray into the rugged camera world is this fairly cheap wrist-mounted camera, the Digital Hero. It's designed for extreme sportsmen like snowboarders and climbers, so they can shoot pictures while keeping their hands free for other important stuff. It's only got 3 megapixels, so the picture quality won't be great, and it doesn't have a screen, so you can't see what you're shooting, but it can record video with sound and has a three-sequence photo burst mode.
This is actually a two-hander, yeah? You need two hands to operate it, which kind of defeats the purpose of having it on your wrist.
Using both hands for the camera isn't ideal, especially when hanging on for dear life in a helicopter, but with the video mode, you can just set it recording and leave it. It's good for 54 minutes of video at a pretty decent resolution. Finally, I've got what I think is the daddy of these rugged cameras, the 8.1 megapixel Ricoh. Its armoured glass protection meets US Department of Defense standards, and it's got a built-in GPS receiver to tag the exact coordinates of a photo.
One thing I will say about the Ricoh, which I'm not impressed with, on these big roller coaster maneuvers, I keep pressing the off button. Whoa! Well, I need to take a shot! You're insane! That's incredible! Wow! Look at that!
As if this ride hadn't been hard enough, the pilot really showed us what he could do on the return leg.
Mission accomplished and started inside out. We headed back to base to study our photos.
That was awesome!
Way of testing cameras. One point I had my arm out, nearly got ripped out of its socket.
I know, that was incredible. And also, this was quite difficult to use, I've got to be honest with you, because of the way the buttons are configured. But when we were turning, it was just impossible.
Ah, well, that's where I won then, because these two were very simple to use.
Don't you start getting smug on me, Missy. Because the real testing, right, the violence that these two little soldiers are built for is still to come. There's no way those two little party pieces can compete with these hardcore special force type things.
Yeah, all that violence is coming up later.
You've broken it.
So stick around if you want to see a grown camera cry.
Oh, they're hot.
Now, I want to talk to you about trainers, which these days are probably the most technologically advanced bits of clothing most of us will buy. Take heels, for example. Every manufacturer has their own special, unique cushioning system that's based around gel, foam, fabric, air, or some other gas. And judging by the names they use to describe this technology, it must be absolutely fantastic. This is the Gel Kinsei 2, the flagship of Japanese company ASICS range. It boasts something called a Trustic system, which is, and I quote, a molded component under the midfoot, providing stability in combination with a specially contoured midsole, which helps to control torsion. It's also got a Dura sponge, a Duo sole, a biomorphic something or other, loads of gel, and the outside of the shoe is coated in a metal called cuprothermo, which apparently absorbs heat from the foot and radiates it outwards. It sounds absolutely fantastic.
And by all accounts, they're pretty accomplished bits of kit. Though in the final analysis, they're just conventional running shoes. What I wanted to test were a couple of much more gadgety pairs of trainers, ones that use microprocessors in an attempt to improve your comfort and performance. So I set off to the Hampshire countryside to meet an expert in running.
This is 400-metre champion Iwan Thomas, one of Britain's most successful athletes, an 8-time international medalist who took home a silver from the 1996 Olympics in Atlanta.
Hello, Iwan.
Hi, John. Are you all right?
Very well, thank you.
Good.
Thank you very much for coming and helping us with this difficult subject of trainers.
There
now,
we are.
Is there a difference between a good trainer and a bad one?
There is, to be honest with you. At the end of the day, when you're running, you've got to appreciate 7 times your body weight is going through your feet. So you need support, and depending on how you run and where you put your body weight, you would get a different trainer.
How do I know how I run? Do I have to film myself?
You can film yourself. If you go to a good sports shop, they will put you on a treadmill and they will film you, and they will look whether you pronate or supinate. In a nutshell, I pronate, which means I'm flat-footed, and when I heel strike, the weight of my feet come inwards. If you supinate, it would go outwards. So I would get a trainer which is an anti-pronator, which would be, if you look at this trainer, for example, it's a lot of support around the heel there, and it's also, it's got a slight arch inside the shoe, so it's built up, so that would stop me collapsing inwards.
So, comfort and support are hugely important to professionals like Iwan. But what happens when trainer manufacturers go beyond the obvious?
Right, Iwan, I'd like you to swap those for these.
Right.
They're Adidas Ones, allegedly the most advanced trainers in the world. Inside each heel is a magnetic sensor that's continuously measuring the terrain you're running over, your weight, your footfall, and there's a computer as well in each shoe, and it tells this motor what to do.
The motor drives a cable system, which tenses and relaxes a cylinder in the shoe's heel. And Adidas promised that no two runners will ever have the same experience.
Look forward to trying these out.
Mmm, like a sort of active shock absorber in a car.
They feel quite stiff. if that makes sense.
Yeah, I can guess. I can relate to that.
Whether that's the support, the continued support they're giving, but yeah. They kind of feel very rigid. I'm half imagining or anticipating to feel the mechanics of the shoe start working. Overall, they are comfortable. I'm not complaining, but the one thing that surprises me, I can't actually feel the mechanics physically
doing anything.
No.
So either could be very subtle, or they maybe just don't do very much.
I don't know. At the moment, I'd say very subtle. Now, obviously, my biomechanics are changing as I run quicker, and they actually feel much better at higher speed.
So with the jury still out on Adidas One, we decided to test some technology that was a little more familiar.
Right, you, and the final pair of trainers I'd like your expert opinion on are these. But it's not so much about the trainers themselves as about the Nike Plus iPod system.
The system relies on a tiny accelerometer slipped into the fabric of a compatible shoe like this Nike Air Pegasus. It gathers a whole load of data as you run. The information's beamed up to the Nano via this receiver, which converts the raw data into various running statistics, speed, distance, time, and calories burned, which are barked out loud at intervals through your iPod's headphones.
Press the center button to begin your workout.
Okay, the lovely lady just whispered in my ear to press the center button to start the workout, so here we go. Current pace, 3:37 per kilometer, so that's probably about 5 minute miling. It feels like it.
Ooh.
It's definitely a quick pace and the shoes feel very comfortable.
3 minutes, 55 seconds completed.
What I really like is the fact that I can be listening to my own chosen music, and on top of that, the woman's voice still comes out. It's very good. Yeah. And the trainers just feel really light, really comfortable. The whole package is a winner.
You're encouraged to upload your statistics via iTunes to the Nike Plus community, where you can view them graphically and compare times and share routes with other community members. And if you run particularly well, Nike Plus will even congratulate you with a recorded message from top athletes, such as Paula Radcliffe and Lance Armstrong.
Well, Lance ain't my mate anymore, he didn't say anything.
Did you hear from Lance in the end?
I did. A true professional. He came through to me in the end and gave me some lovely advice.
Well, it's very good of you to drop in. It's very nice to have visitors.
Pleasure.
Now, you've had a bit of time to think about these, and it's normal on the Gadget to rate everything out of 5 in G rating. So to start with, what do you think of these Adidas ones? I got the impression you weren't very impressed with all that technology underneath.
The rating for that would be a 2. They were all singing, all dancing. They looked fantastic, but I was left disappointed with them, to be honest with you. I thought they were going to be really, really good. They were too stiff for me. As an out-and-out running shoe, they didn't have the comfort of the others, so 2 out of 5.
Mm. And G's for the Nikes?
The Nikes will get a 4G rating. Mm. They were really good. I was a little bit worried they're going to be typical Nike fashionable shoes.
Yeah.
But the actual trainer, the Nike Air Pegasus, was brilliant. And the technology that goes with it, with the iPod, wasn't a gimmick at all. Right. It was really useful. It gave me current updates of how I was running. So 4 G's out of 5.
Mm.
Right, time now to return to our rugged digital camera test. Now, you may remember that Jason and I took the cameras up in a helicopter to take a few pictures of the fantastic views of Iceland, just to see how well the cameras performed in extreme conditions. But what was the quality of the photos like? Well, as you know, our resident photography expert is Jon Bentley. However, he wasn't in Iceland with us. He was busy running around the New Forest with a man called Iwan. So how would we get him to assess our photographs? Well, by setting up a state-of-the-art high-def webcam link, of course.
So Jon could see our action shots in all their glory, we headed back to the hotel where we'd set up a brand new 15 grand high-def video link system called Life Size.
Hello, Jon Bentley, this is Reykjavik calling.
Hello, Reykjavik, London here. We're receiving you loud and clear.
So, Jon, we've got 4 sets of photographs for you to have a look at. Jason and I went up in the helicopter, we had 2 cameras each, and we want you to rate them as to which you think is best.
Suzy and Jason had used all the cameras set to automatic, so I'd be judging the pictures they took on a completely level playing field.
First up, Jon looked through the pictures from the 7.1 megapixel Pentax Optio.
Actually, well, that looks pretty good. I mean, it's obviously there's a lot of difference in light there. I mean, you'll have bright light coming in through the window of the helicopter, which explains why you're possibly looking slightly overexposed. And the colours are very natural.
Ooh.
There's nowhere like Iceland, is there? It's a natural film set. That's lovely sort of geothermal colours there. That's fantastic, isn't it?
Come on.
Oh, he looks like a lovely moon, doesn't he?
These all look great. I think I'd be pretty pleased if I came back from Iceland with those pictures.
So, a big thumbs up for the Pentax Optios photos. The next set came from my 7.1 megapixel Olympus Mew.
Grey day on Reykjavik golf course.
Well, but actually...
But that also, it does look good for a grey day in Reykjavik over the golf course. It's even different, but in some ways even better colours than the previous camera.
Well, actually, the definition on that is very
it's
striking,
really good,
isn't it, on
the
that
moss
shot?
The moss is really rich, isn't it? Yeah.
OK.
It's all great colours again. I mean, it's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
I like that. Ooh. So obviously, these first two cameras, they both look good to me from here, anyway.
Onto my two cameras, and I started with the set from my chunky 8.1 megapixel Ricoh.
It doesn't quite seem to have emphasised the colours and the characteristics of the landscape quite so much. I mean, it looks sharp, but it also looks ever so slightly flat to me. It almost looks as though you've got some sort of mist on the front of the lens. Maybe the lens was wet or something.
No, I think that is actually the quality of the camera. I just love that. I just think that is the coolest piece of kit. This is the sophisticated piece of technology that the chase camera used in order to take nice, smooth shots of us in our helicopter.
And as a shot, I mean, it looks very sharp. I can read all the tiny letters on the helicopter. Again, it seems to be pretty well exposed. But again, I just get that slight feeling as though you've got something between the lens and what you're photographing.
The shots from my Ricoh weren't as clear as they could have been, and Jon wasn't too keen. All I had left to pin my hopes on were the efforts from my 3-megapixel wrist-mounted action camera, the Digital Hero.
There you go, Jon.
Well, I mean, to me, compared to the other ones, the colours on that just don't look quite right. It almost looks like something you'd take with your mobile phone, probably. I mean, and also, again, it's not very sharp, which makes me think it's probably the thing that's... That bit of apparatus that's hanging around your wrist, Jason.
I'll move on to this one.
It looks like a bit of sandstone in Worcestershire that you've accidentally taken with your phone while you're out on a walk. It doesn't do much for me. That looks very blurred, and the colours don't look very good.
Jon wasn't impressed with the Digital Heroes shots, putting it quite definitely in last place.
Not only were my Pentax and Olympus the easiest to use under extreme conditions, but also gave the best quality pictures because Jon said so.
Yeah.
And before you butt in, I think you might have called them party cams earlier.
I did. I stand corrected. I mean, I've got to be absolutely honest with you. I thought they were the best shots as well of the bunch. I was really disappointed by the Ricoh, weren't you?
Yeah, I was.
I mean,
actually,
you know, this is a premier camera brand. It's the most expensive of the four cameras. It's built like a tank. You know, it's there to get the job done, isn't it? With its GPS and all the rest of it on board, you'd think it'd take a good picture, and it just didn't.
Because we didn't, I mean, you wouldn't have thought that would have taken a great shot.
No, this is an inexpensive camera to be worn by, you know, people who are into sports and jumping out of aeroplanes and snowboarding and what have you. So it wasn't a big disappointment, but still, I will say though, Suze, the going is about to get seriously tough. That's what this is about, all right? These cameras are about ruggedness.
Yeah, well, all that violence.
About still violence.
To come, all that ruggedness still to come. But first of all, focus group. Each week on the focus group, Jon, Jason and I present the best gadget that each of us can find in a particular category to our focus group, who, as you can see, are a marvellously attractive group of people who just happen to be randomly passing the studio that we dragged in from the street. And in a totally unscientific piece of research, they are going to tell us which gadget they like best. Now, this week, we're looking at gadgets that take you a step closer to the movies. Jon, you're up first.
Now, this is the perfect way to watch movies when you're at home. But can you get the spectacle, the involvement, the enjoyment of that when you're on the bus? Yes. I have here the Easy Vision video spectacles. They're very compact, and inside them are two LCD screens in there. Just plug it straight into the iPod or indeed any other multimedia player. We've used them on DVD players, even on a Microsoft Zoom. But don't take my word for it, try it for yourself.
Whoa. Really surreal. I didn't think it would be that big.
Oh. It's actually better than my TV, which is really depressing.
Don't you think you'd look like a bit of a nut job on the tube, though? Or someone tried to steal your bags, you'd be like...
So, there we are, the Easy Vision video specs. What do you think yours will be better than these?
I don't know.
I think you went down rather well.
You won quite a few votes, I reckon, John. I'll give it a go, though. OK. All right? All right, everyone, we're going on an outing, a field trip. Come this way, please, focus group. OK, I want to show you a clever piece of software that takes your home videos and makes them look like they were shot in Hollywood. Now, I hear that one of you is a bit of an amateur filmmaker. Am I right? Is that you, sir?
That would be me.
Are you Tom?
I am Tom.
Come and join us. We've imported Tom's movie, which is freaky, honestly, into this piece of software. What's the idea of the movie?
It's just some sort of parody art piece, really.
Parody art piece. Yeah. I haven't got a clue what it means. Maybe someone at home does. There it is on the screen. So now what this software is going to do, hopefully, is to apply an overall effect to it that hopefully as a filmmaker, you know, you'll be happy with. I'll show you what I mean. I click load. There you go. So you've got Bleach Bypass, Island Paradise. That's pretty Hollywood, isn't it? Pretty tinsel town, yeah? Normally, within a sort of professional film or television environment, that would be, you know, a few hours process. You know, it would take an awful long time. And already, I'm able to play the sequence you've just seen in real time with that Hollywood effect applied. Here we go, check it out. There you go. See, I reckon for a film that's basically about a man with a red and white face, that's pretty quids, isn't it?
That's what you want.
Yeah.
That's exactly what you want, yeah.
Marvellous.
And finally, walk over here. Walk this way. We're using all of the studio today. Right, chaps, do you know what this is?
Green screen.
Green screen, exactly. You've probably seen it in movies that talk about making movies like Star Wars, to drop in backdrops, save money, save time, all that sort of thing. But now you can make your own green screen sequences at home with the Creation Station. So you get the green screen here, you've got your Creation Station, which is effectively this little camera, and some software which I've already downloaded onto the computer. Now I need two volunteers. Are there any sci-fi, Star Wars-y fans amongst you? Okay, lightsabers for the pair of you. I've got a couple of marks for you to stand on there. They'll be in the perfect position. There they are on the screen. Looking good. So now I'm recording the footage and it's got the green background. Brilliantly done, guys. Thank you very much. Right then, once you've recorded your action, the Creation Station drops the background that you want into any part of the screen that's green and hey presto. Here it is!
That's great. Focus group, it's time to quite literally stand up and be counted, okay? You've got to imagine that you've only got enough money to buy one of the three movie gadgets that you've seen. So, starting with John, stand up if John's the one that you'd like to have. One vote for John's specs. If you're interested in my Hollywood effects movie system, please stand up.
Jason, you've won me.
Oh, good. Thank you. What? I can take you home with me, is that what you're trying to say?
Literally.
It's not that kind of show, but thank you very much. Okay, and finally, Susie's. I think I know where this is going. Susie's Creation Station. Stand up if that's your kettle of fish. Look at that. Yay! Resounding victory.
Very good.
It doesn't count the two. They're only there because they've got to be Jedis. Look.
Also really cool to show you, it's a Bluetooth headset.
Susie, you know full well there is no such thing as a cool Bluetooth headset.
Well, I knew you were going to say that, but look at this. This is the jawbone. You know the problem normally is you put them on and you just don't look very cool, do you?
It's quite good looking, isn't it?
Yeah?
It is. It matches your top, which
helps. It looks cool, but also the call quality sometimes not very good. You can't really hear each other, can you? This is military grade technology. Okay? So it's got sensors on it that dynamically control the volume in your ear and also on the microphone. So it's cancelling out any surrounding noise in extreme conditions. And apparently it's so good that you're supposed to be able to hear each other in a rave.
It's a shame we don't record the show in a nightclub, isn't it?
Right. So I want to test it. So go out into the corridor.
Hey.
Go into the corridor and go as far away from the noise as possible.
Right.
And then ring me. See if you can hear me, and I can hear you.
OK, you want me to go out for a poo?
No, go on!
This way. This way, come on. This way. No music. Right, I'll give her a call. I've got her number saved on the iPhone. Now, what I'm going to do is put it on speakerphone if she answers, and put it near my mic so that you can hear her voice, which hopefully should be clear.
Here we go. Here's the call. Hi, Jace.
Hi, Susie. Can you hear me? Well, I can actually hear you very well. I mean, it's a little bit crackly, but it's very good considering that you're in the middle of a rave.
Yeah, well, I agree with you. It's a tiny bit crackly, but
the quality of your voice is actually pretty good.
Well, I've got to say, I'm really, really impressed. And I've always hated Bluetooth headsets, so this could well turn me. Wrong number. No idea who that was. We're about to return to Iceland and test our four ruggedized cameras to destruction.
We already know that my Pentax and Olympus take the best pictures, but can they really be that tough?
I'll tell you what is tough. A tank! And that's basically what these two cameras are. Look, covered in plastic cladding, two big beefcakes of photography. That one, Steven Seagal. That one, my mate Chalky from school. Very small, very, you know, sort of spindly, but dead hard!
Iceland sits right on the join between the continental plates of America and Europe, and as a result, is regularly hit by earthquakes and volcanic eruptions, which is perfect for us. All that bubbling geothermal activity just below the surface makes for some pretty extreme testing. Well, not too extreme to start with, eh?
This is the world-famous Blue Lagoon Spa. The 40-degree water is seawater that is superheated by being pumped up past a lava flow, and the place is renowned as a health treatment for pretty much whatever ails you.
All our cameras claim a level of water resistance, so a relaxing bathe is an ideal test.
Tell you what, this place is great. Sorry, I just squished some volcanic stuff on you.
Both my cameras have impressive waterproof abilities. In fact, the RNLI issue Pentax Optios to their lifeboat crews to document rescues. The reinforced seals give it a claimed water resistance down to 3 meters for up to 2 hours, which is more than enough time to get wrinkly fingers. The thing I like very much about this Pentax is on the back on the LCD display, it's got a special coating and the water runs off really quickly, so you don't end up with loads of drips on it. The Pentax's only real rival in the waterproof stakes is my other camera, the Olympus. This little Olympus here, you can shoot down to 10 meters, so good if you're diving. It includes 4 different underwater modes, not that they were much use in this cloudy, mineral-rich water.
Because my digital hero is entombed in its plastic case, it's allegedly waterproof down to 30 meters, which is more than anyone realistically would ever need. And it coped easily with a gentle bathe.
This little hero on my wrist is fantastic. I mean, it feels tough, it feels rugged, it feels like I could do anything all day with it, not even notice it was there, take shots when I want to, and it wouldn't let me down.
If only the same could be said for my military-grade Rico.
And there's water inside the housing, which is meant to be good for 1 meter underwater. Can you see? I don't know if you can see on the screen there. There's actual water inside the camera. Really not very good at all. And that's aside from issues like it being hard to focus and having a very long lag between shots. You take a shot and you wait about 2 or 3 seconds before it actually comes up for preview, or you can take another one. 100 quid, 650 quid.
One camera down and blooming annoyed, we took out my frustrations on the remaining cameras by boiling them in volcanic springs.
99% of Iceland's electricity comes from harnessing the geothermal power that creates these bubbling, seething pools that can reach up to 100 degrees. But even more dangerous is the highly, highly corrosive sulfur content. Laden with sulfur. No, it's not me, before you ask.
To protect ourselves from burns and corrosion, we went for the extremely scientific protection afforded by a children's fishing net.
Goodbye, little camera. Good luck.
Good luck, boys. Here we go. Ready?
Oh! Bring them up. Oh, they're hot.
We dunked them in the boiling mud, then washed them off in the sulphurous water of the hot springs. Nice and hot and bubbling, there you go.
Oh, it's a bit frisky one.
Nice and clean, look.
Nice and hot, ow.
We left them for a few minutes to cool down before testing them to see if they'd survived.
Both my cameras still worked after the test.
Oh, beautiful.
But there was a moment when my little digital hero looked like it was a goner.
The LED display's working, but it's not actually taking pictures.
That sounds like a picture. It is working.
With all three remaining cameras still in action, there was nothing left for it but to bury them in a volcano. When in Rome and all that. This particular volcano is part of a massive chain that last erupted about 200 years ago and is still cooling down.
You can already feel the heat right here when you just put your hand there.
You can feel the heat on the surface, but look, if I dig away, watch yourself, Suze.
Yeah.
Just a few centimetres deeper than this. Can you see the steam coming out? It can get up to 400 degrees.
Ooh, look at that.
The cameras are dustproof. We weren't sure if that extended to superheated volcanic dust, but we'd find out soon enough.
Good luck, little camera.
Switch it off, drop it in. Welcome to hell, little cameras.
Okay.
We left them baking in the volcanic heat.
Eventually, it was time to get them out. Could any of them possibly have survived?
We'll go with the Pentax first.
Okay.
Good. Oh, on. Fine.
Functioning.
Absolutely fine. Take a picture of you. Oh, you look like a hamster. Great. Looks perfectly
natural,
fine.
Yeah? Let's try the Olympus then.
Okay, Olympus next. Obviously, same as Pentax, completely covered in gunk. You're on. You're there. You're in. Handsome.
Oh. Press the on button, which is possibly the flimsiest thing in the camera. Is this going to come on? Yes! 20 pictures, which is where I've got to. Say cheese.
Cheese.
Nice pearly white, Suzy Perry.
Mm-hmm.
21, yes, it's working.
All survived and all working.
Well, it seems as though these three cameras are almost gadget show proof, let alone being dustproof, shockproof and waterproof.
Well, what about this, though? I mean, the Blue Lagoon, yeah? Mm. You'd think that was at the ideal location to test a camera, which we were told is waterproof to 1 metre, OK? Within 5 minutes, the back screen here display, that was full of water. The lens was full of water. I mean, look at that, all the corrosion around the flash area. The whole thing is full of corrosion. There's rust coming out the bottom of the GPS bit there. Completely trashed. Over 600 quid's worth of kit in 5 minutes.
That's a great big pretender, that is.
Yeah. One down.
Mm-hmm.
Three to go. Now, one thing that keeps us endlessly amused in the Gadget Show team is sending Suzy off around the world to try out ever more ridiculous forms of personal transport.
Yeah, thanks. Now, I've ridden and fallen off some pretty strange contraptions over the last few years. In Holland, I had a go at the ill-conceived wheel surf.
Nice.
That was utterly ridiculous. What a crazy, crazy idea that was. And then I went to Spain, and much to your amusement, remember the old...
Pumper-dumper bike.
No, pumper bike.
Pumper-dumper bike.
Pumper bike.
Oh. Who am I?
Oh. That is the most ridiculous thing I ever had to do. So now perhaps you can imagine just how terrified I was when they said to me, oh, we've got you booked on a flight to Switzerland to test an apparently brilliant new form of personal transport.
This is the Easy Glider, and if you think it looks like a wheel on a stick, well, you're right. Despite its minimalist appearance, it's being touted as a real rival to the Segway.
So here it is then, and it is a wheel on a stick, but it's quite a cool wheel on a stick. This is George from Easy Glider, the tech guy behind it. How does it work?
Well, actually, it's quite simple.
Yeah?
It's battery powered. You have an electric motor in there. Basically, you just stand on it.
Mm.
You push down the steering bar so the kickstand jumps up. You have a throttle, this ring here, that's the throttle. You have a front brake.
And how fast does it go?
It goes 20 kilometers an hour.
Straight into the sea over there.
All right.
Okay, and does it turn quite easily?
You just use it like you would use a motorbike or a bicycle. When you want to turn, you go into the bends and you just tilt it into the bend. And obviously you have to move with your body as well.
So you do move your body a little bit as
Absolutely,
well?
Absolutely, you have
and
to.
And bend your knees slightly, do you?
A little bit, like you would be on skis.
Okay.
Okay?
Right.
Switch it on here and now you can just throttle and off you go and have a go on it.
Who picked a marina for this location? Here we go then. Woo!
It was conceived in 2001 by a Swiss figure skater called Stefan Soda. Tired of always having to rollerblade home from training with sore legs, Stefan wanted a contraption that would pull him around on his inline skates. Maneuverability was really important to Stefan. He discovered that with just one wheel, the vehicle could make tight turns without losing any speed, and that this gliding round bends could be controlled as precisely as ski turns.
I think I'm getting this pretty good, this turning. That's quite tight.
Speed up a little bit.
Trying to get the bomb action. Is that better?
It looks sexy.
Woo!
Yes, it does.
Normally, George, you know, on this show, when they send me out, test gadgets, they make me look really stupid.
No, you don't look stupid. Not at all. It looks good.
See you, Jason.
Early Easy Glider prototypes did tend to resemble tin lawnmowers, but these are really stylish. This is the X6 model, the very latest design, powered by a 360-watt battery that recharges itself when you're cruising downhill.
Once you get the gist of it and you relax, it's completely simple.
It's easy. That's why it's called Easy Glider. Yeah.
So easy, in fact, that the wheel on a stick has rapidly become a very popular form of transport in its native Switzerland, where over 2,000 have been sold in the last 3 years.
Oh, this is so cool! It's much better being on the gravel. There's much more jeopardy involved. The wonderful thing about this is that it just does all the work for you. It just pulls you along, and all you have to do is have a laugh.
I can't believe what I'm looking at.
What?
Suzy Perry on a personal transport device and she doesn't look stupid.
You know what? It gets even better because if you take the chariot off, hold on to this.
I will.
You can use it to tow you around and other stuff like you and Thomas, Jason and I did earlier today when it was still light outside.
I have.
I can only go.
Not very strong.
Welcome back, and let's go straight over to Iceland for this week's spectacular Tested to Destruction.
Where Suzy and I are going to finally pulverise our three remaining ruggedised cameras.
Everywhere you turn in Iceland, there's an opportunity to seriously damage something, which we love.
For the final test, we used the £60,000 super truck that had been ferrying us around the island. We attached the cameras to the back with some chains to test once and for all just how hardcore they are.
They'd be dragged across this rocky, gravelly, volcanic beach.
So let me just attach the final one before these little babies get the absolute kicking of their life.
With the cameras attached, we gave our Icelandic driver the signal to go.
All right, Ingi, pedal to metal. Let's do it.
Good luck, little camera. Good luck.
Oh, they're going to attack each other. They're fighting.
They're like punchers. Look at them.
This was the ultimate test of how our cameras could stand up to the bumps, knocks and drops that come with the active lifestyle they're designed for.
Just look at the ground, look. This is what we're talking about, look. Massive, great big rocks, look. Everywhere. OK, you get your fine sand, but at some point, you know, 10 or 20 metres, you get these, don't you? Big, big clumps of these great big things. Oh!
The Pentax Optio only claims to be waterproof, but the insides of the camera are made of the same metal as the outside, which would hopefully toughen it up a bit. Oh.
Oh! Mine took a kick in then.
The Digital Hero sits in a reinforced plastic shockproof housing. If you've got this on your wrist when you're snowboarding and say you've come off, this is the kind of impact it would need to stand up to.
Come back!
Come on, Ingi, put your foot down!
Again!
What's Icelandic for pedal to metal? Oh, splurdy! Go on, my son!
Oh, that's Norwegian.
It's the Olympus Mew that should have been the daddy here. It's crush-proof against weights of 100 kilograms. It also claims to be shockproof and can survive drops from 1.5 metres.
Probably weren't made to withstand.
Probably not, within their design
parameters. But they might do!
Parameters. Yeah. Hang on, it's coming for us now.
Oh, should we move?
I think maybe we should...
Which way?
The cameras were dragged round on lap after lap of this desolate beach. They seem to be holding up, but then I notice something wrong.
Come on, Inge.
How many have we got?
Hang on. Is there one missing?
We're missing one of them, maybe two of them. We're missing...
Oh, we've lost one. We've lost the Pentax.
What happened next? Did we find the Pentax? Were the other two cameras working? Did Suzy and I make it home? Well, obviously we made it home because we're here, but it was very exciting.
Yeah, and we did find the Pentax. All that's missing is the little ring that goes around the lens there. But look at it, it's absolutely battered and scratched.
It's trashed on the outside.
It's trashed, but the amazing thing is, watch this, it still works! Ugly mug! It's still working.
It does.
By the way, is the Olympus. Of course, it's completely scratched on both sides as well. Well, you would be, wouldn't you, after you'd been through that violence.
Yeah, I mean, that beach was incredible.
That beach was amazing, though, wasn't it? Yeah,
volcanic. The rocks were massive, and I mean, it was a huge beach, and that car just kept going up and down for about half an hour.
The little hero didn't survive, though.
No, amazingly, despite the very rugged housing that it's got, the plastic housing, which was bulletproof and had a big sort of lock on the end of it, which I thought would take most of the punishment that we gave it, the case cracked, and then obviously the camera gave up the ghost. It's not particularly scratched or anything, it just won't turn on, so I think the impact did for it.
But these two were absolute outright stars,
weren't
they?
Yeah, really impressive. Survived every test we could throw at them. OK, Suze, what about G ratings?
Well, you know what? I'm going to give both of them 4 Gs because they were both absolute superstars. I mean, they don't look rugged, but they were fantastic. Recommend both of them highly.
I was beaten fair and square.
You were.
You